everyone, welcome to another episode of Lowdown.
In this episode, we explore a local record shop, take a trip to a film festival, and have an exclusive interview with two actresses from the Netflix hit series, Orange is the New Black. All of this and so much more coming your way on this episode of Lowdown. Hey guys, welcome to Lowdown, your source for all things music, arts, and entertainment happening around town. I'm Josh.
And I'm Jenna. Okay, so Josh, I feel like I owe you an apology. I feel really bad for making fun of you about listening to Pandora way back in the first episode.
It's okay, Jenna. I forgive you.
Good, because I've actually been using an even older method of listening to music lately.
Really? How?
Records. I have been feeling nostalgic recently, so I figured why not?
Well, records have been surprisingly making a comeback, and there are even record stores that are still around today.
Good, I really need to find a good shop.
Well, you're in luck. Leslie recently got an interview with the owner of Time Traveler Record Shop. Let's take a look.
My name's Scott Shepherd, and the name of the store is Time Traveler Records. I grew up collecting records, and I had a pretty good collection when I started my own store way back in 1980. I started my first ever store with mostly my collection of records that I had. A pretty large, extensive one. I mean, I had, you know, a couple thousand albums that I'd been collecting since I was a kid. And, you know, when I was real young, I didn't take really good care of them. But by the time I got to be, you know, about 15 or 16, I started taking really good care of my records, and I started, you know, just compiling a really nice collection of stuff. I have 6,000 CDs in my own collection. It would take like 2 hours to even begin to tell you, you know, different artists I love. You know, it started for me with the Beatles. I was 9 years old when they were on Ed Sullivan, and that just, you know, that got me into the whole music scene, and I started collecting records at that point. And there's so many artists I love that, you know, I love rock and classical and jazz and blues and just all kinds of different genres. Well, the Beatles have always kind of been my favorite band, but yeah, there's just, you know, I love like Kate Bush and Peter Gabriel and Pink Floyd, and, you know, even some of the newer stuff. I like Death Cab for Cutie. I think they're a really good band. I have two younger daughters that are always turning me on to the newer music and the cool new bands that I probably wouldn't listen to if it wasn't for them. Well, I try to carry just, you know, everything I can. If you look in, especially with vinyl, I try to carry all different genres and have a lot, you know, everything from back, basically, before the Beatles and all that British Invasion stuff. And I have a lot of the new releases and different stuff, and a lot of bands that are popular today. I try to keep, you know, pretty much everything in stock. Oh, sure, yeah, I buy, sell, and trade all the time. I'm looking for, you know, everything from like the 60s, 70s, 80s, everything, you know, on up. As long as condition's pretty important, especially on vinyl. People that buy vinyl nowadays, they look at both sides under a bright light, and they make sure it's in really clean shape, and I totally understand that. Well, I'm on 118 West Market Street. Yep. I'm open at 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. every day but Sunday, directly across from Dave Tal Cadillac. It's convenient, lots of parking.
Such a cool little shop. It's like a blast from the past with a very fitting name.
Well, Jenna, get your time machine ready, because this time we're going even farther back into the past. Jack Stern takes us to Ohio Shakespeare Festival, held right here in Akron.
Oh, I love Shakespeare. Let's take a look.
I'm Tess Bergler. I'm the managing director of Ohio Shakespeare Festival, particularly here at Greystone Hall. And I'm also an actor, a founding company member. We wear a lot of hats here. So Ohio Shakespeare Festival has been performing outdoors at Stan Hewitt Hall and Gardens each summer for the past 15 years. And our motto or slogan, whatever you want to call it, is don't read Shakespeare. Our whole point of that is don't read Shakespeare, see Shakespeare live. We think that Shakespeare is really understandable, accessible, exciting for modern audiences and for a whole bunch of different kinds of people. But you have to see it. You can't read it, at least at first, to fall in love with it. And so we want to make live Shakespeare accessible to everybody. So this season, we get Robin Hood Family Theater right off the bat, and then we're gonna finally do complete works of William Shakespeare abridged, which is totally ridiculous, hilarious, 90 minutes, all the plays, and quite a good following if you love the reduced Shakespeare company. Then after that, we're gonna branch out a little bit and do some more modern stuff. Lone Star, which definitely has some adult language and content in it, is really charming, really beautiful piece that really has nothing to do with Shakespeare, so we're gonna see what our audiences think about that. And Upstart Crow, which is about Shakespeare's daughter and his best friend Burbage, but written by a modern playwright. And then after that, we wanna put some Shakespeare on the stage just to say, hey, this is us, this is what we do. And we're gonna bring Comedy of Errors, which, short, sweet, hilarious. No one doesn't like that one. We're back at Stan Hewitt for the summer with As You Like It and The Winter's Tale. And finally back here a year from now with another family theater production, The Three Musketeers. Other things that we offer besides the flat out shows are, I think, things that maybe Akron University students would really enjoy. The first thing I want to mention is Fight Night. The second Monday of every month at 7 o'clock, we offer a 90 minute fight workshop, and that's stage combat. So our last one in October was Merry Swordplay to sort of celebrate Robin Hood, but it was the basics of sort of that swashbuckling style of fencing, or swordplay, I shouldn't say fencing, it wasn't fencing. But our fight director will choose the theme for every month. It's only $15, 10 if you're a student, and it's drop in, drop out, so come whenever you want. But if you're an actor, these are the kinds of skills that you need, and you really can't find them for this cheap or this good in the area anywhere else, at least that I know of. So beyond just going to the theater, I think you actually get a true community experience here.
To be or not to be, that is the question. I think I'm ready to be the next Hamlet.
Okay, well, while Josh practices for his big break, we are gonna go to our first commercial break. Welcome back to Lowdown. We hope you didn't miss us too much.
So, Jenna, you know what I was thinking about the other day?
What?
How much hidden talent there is on campus.
What do you mean?
Well, like Rob Quartz went to Collage, which is basically one big concert held here on campus at EJ Thomas. It showcases the whole school of music.
That sounds awesome. Let's check it out.
And I'm the coordinator of music education here at the University of Akron School of Music. Our collage concert is our annual showcase for the School of Music. We have a continuous concert, so groups appear on stage, in the balcony, off to the side, in the doorways. They appear at various places throughout the hall, and when one group stops, the lights go off on that group and the lights come up in another part of the hall and the next group performs and there's no applause. So it's a continuous concert and we applaud at the end of the first act, and then the second act we do the same thing all over again. It's one of our favorite days of the year in the School of Music because the students get a chance to see one another. If you're in the flute studio, you're going to see a lot of the band concerts and you're going to see a lot of the woodwind events and things like that, but you might not always see the choir, or you might not see the jazz ensemble, or you might not see the steel drum band. So we love this day. It's a really special day in the life of the School of Music because we get to see one another and watch one another perform, and it's a really wide variety. Seventh year of the Collage concert, and every year it's completely different. We have many of the same groups that perform, but the groups vary, and every year the repertoire is different and where they are in the house is different, and so it's an exciting performance.
Lights will guide.
you sit in the hall, you're going to get kind of a different experience. If you sit right down in the main orchestra seats, especially at the end, our last song, and so the symphonic band was on the stage, and then the brass from the concert band were in the balcony. So you end up with kind of a surround sound sensation when you're sitting down there. It just depends on where you sit. We have a lot of things going on in the School of Music. They're almost always free for students, so we welcome everybody to come and check us out in Gazetta Recital Hall or in E.J. Thomas Hall. And they can like us on Facebook, the University of Akron School of Music, or follow us on Twitter at UAkronMusic.
Pretty cool. I'll definitely have to check that out next time.
Yeah, me too. So, Josh, do you have any new music recommendations? I've been looking for some new tunes.
No, I don't. But you know who always gives us the lowdown on new music? Jack Stern. We take you now to Jack with his latest music reviews.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jack Stern, and I'm here to give you the memo on the latest music. Let's not waste too much time with a corny intro, though, because I've got a lot to cover this time. First up is Jeff Rosenstock's new record, Worry. Now I gotta say, this album feels like a shot of pop-punk oxygen after the less-than-desirable pop-punk record I reviewed last time. Jeff Rosenstock takes a no-holds-barred approach to this record and lets his personality fly all over the place. Coming off his record from last year, We Cool, he continues to develop his own unique punk sound, one that is soaked in immaturity, self-deprecation, and even some insightful social commentary for good measure. The second half of the album wades into these little minute-long vignettes as each track transitions perfectly into one another. This is a cool idea as it gives the album a more live feel, but at the same time it diminishes the impact of some of the less interesting punk guitars that are prevalent across the album. However, there's still a lot of variety in the instrumentals, and Rosenstock's vocals always provide enough energy and distinction that I never felt like there was a dull moment at all on this record. This album definitely impressed me, and I don't feel any hesitation in giving it 4.5 stars out of 5. Next up is the new album, A Front Row Seat to Earth, from indie folk outfit Ways Blood. Lead vocalist Natalie Marion continues to evolve upon her origins in experimental noise rock as she develops a much softer sound. However, she never quite reaches the levels of melancholy and softness from her other Ways Blood records, like The Outside Room. Marion's vocals maintain the same airy persona that she has kept these past few records, and for the most part, this is still pretty captivating. There are still some strong musical moments that carry this album, though. A good example is the progression from psychedelic noises to a triumphant bass and synth climax on the track Do You Need My Love. Overall, though, I was left wanting just a little bit more on this record. My verdict for this album is going to come down to 3.5 stars out of 5. Next is Joanne, the latest album from A-list pop star Lady Gaga. Personally, I never cared for Gaga's previous work beyond the occasional single. I always felt that her pop instrumentals were too busy and tried too hard to have that club banger sound without having any raw emotion behind them. Joanne feels like it was made to address these concerns, as it abandons the heavy electronic sound of her other work and goes for a more organic country sound. This record does a great job of melding Gaga's voice and personality in with these country instrumentals and themes. Her voice really manages to stand out whenever it meshes with these twangy guitars and rock instrumentals. However, not all of the tracks on this record make a full commitment to this changeover. Songs like Ayo and Perfect Illusion only have a light use of guitars and have a really regimented and electronic feel that is really just at odds with all the laid-back tracks on this album. The strongest tracks on this album, like Joanne and Hey Girl, are actually the ones where it doesn't feel like Gaga is trying to be the most over-the-top that she can be. Altogether, this release is still pretty fun. It may not reinvent the wheel in terms of pop music, but delivers on its hooks and has memorable lyrics, which is pretty much all I can ask for from a pop record. I'm feeling a strong 3 out of 5 stars in this record. Next up is the latest album from a collaborative hip-hop duo, No Worries. Yes Lord continues Anderson .Paak's hot streak as he teams up with producer Knowledge for this record. The result is a project that pulsates with sultry R&B vibes. Anderson .Paak's vocals are as strong as ever. His lyrics describe love in a way that is both alluring and raunchy. He gives a really good range of vocal performances, from singing to rapping and even spoken word sections. Tracks such as Link Up and Like This have extremely infectious hooks as Anderson rides the groove of each instrumental with ease. Knowledge crafts beats that use soulful samples cut with obscure and sometimes hilarious vocal samples that add to the narrative of each track. Many of the songs on this record are pretty simple and don't really go beyond a simple loop sample and a catchy hook. This gives the album a sort of mishmash feel that prevents it from reaching the upper echelons of records that have influenced itself. Nevertheless, I still had a really good time listening to this record, and I'm feeling 4 out of 5 stars on this album. That's about all I've got for you today, folks. Tune in next time for more scoops on the latest music on Lowdown.
Thanks, Jack. You always give us the best reviews on new music.
Yeah, you basically provide me with a new playlist every episode.
So, Jenna, I have some pretty exciting news. Have you ever heard of the show Orange is the New Black?
Yeah, it's on Netflix, right?
Yeah, it's an awesome series, and I got the opportunity to interview 2 of the stars of the show.
No way! How did you land that?
Well, they came to the University of Akron to encourage voters, and I was lucky enough to get an interview with the 2 of them.
That's so exciting. Let's watch.
Today I'm standing here with Kate Mulgrew and Taylor Schilling from Orange New Black, the Netflix hit series. So can you tell me what you guys are doing here today?
We are here to ask people to vote.
So Orange is New Black touches on a lot of major social issues that are very relevant to today's society. Have you guys been able to incorporate aspects of the show to help encourage voters to get them out to the polls?
Well, I think it's very interesting. Interestingly enough, this job is sort of what, my job right now is sort of what has gotten me here, talking to you right now. I think that as your worldview opens and you learn a bit more about whatever your chosen field is, in this case, I think Kate and I learned a lot more about the criminal justice system than we had in the past. You become inherently political. It's very difficult not to see what's happening in the world and then not want to do something about it. And so I think that that's not only been our experience working on it from the inside, but that's been the experience of many viewers. And this election has a great specific impact on the issues that Orange is the New Black raises.
Also, additionally, it's wonderful and serendipitous that because we're on this show, Orange is the New Black, and we've been elevated to this level of exposure, we can come and hopefully make some kind of a difference. So everything works.
You know, you both have found major success from this show. Like, how have you been using that to encourage voters and help change these social issues?
Well, in this way. I went to a fundraiser a few weeks ago in New York. I invited Taylor. She came. She came, you know, without question, unhesitatingly. And while there, she met a lot of people who fell instantly in love with her. And they all said, will you come to Ohio? And she didn't miss a beat. She said, yes, I will. So here we are. I married into Ohio politics, so I'm here for that reason.
Great.
Say anything else to that?
No, I mean, I think we're here. This is what it means to sort of believe in something.
And are there any certain issues that you're very passionate about?
Certainly the criminal justice system, I think women's issues, and right now gun control are big issues.
That's a big one, gun control. Immigration for me, big. But women's rights, of course, human rights. And we're here to espouse them all.
That's awesome. I still can't believe you got to meet and talk with 2 famous actresses.
I know, they're both so great at what they do. And I was sort of nervous at first, but they're super down to earth and the interview went great.
Well, I'm beyond jealous. I want to hear all about it.
Well, while I tell Jenna more about my awesome experience, let's take a quick commercial break.
Welcome back to Lowdown.
So far, we've talked about and seen a lot of cool stuff, but I'm a little surprised we haven't seen any new artists on the scene yet.
Well, the show's not over yet. I happened to catch an artsy sort of event on campus that ended up being a lot of fun. ZPN held its first ever Don't Wine, Just Paint event in honor of Alcohol Awareness Week, and it was pretty successful. And I brought Jack along with me to take part in the fun.
Hi, my name is Ellie Bonema. I am the Fine Arts Film and Lecture Chair for ZPN. And I coordinated Don't Wine, Just Paint, which is a brand new program this year. It's a part of Alcohol Awareness Week, so all the events this week are centered around kind of raising awareness about alcohol and also bringing light to students' alcohol alternative events that they could do. So this event was kind of just showing students that you don't necessarily need alcohol to have a good time.
Hi, my name is Carol Medhurst, and I was a painter at the Akron Society of Artists, right down here in Akron. A small group of people, but a wonderful group of artists. And my name, I guess, was in the membership, and so somebody found me. And I said yes, because I love working with college students and I love painting, so it was a perfect blend. My goal here tonight is to just share my passion, which is painting, and to have fun, because I've been to these events before, and I've taught them, and I've been on the other side, and it's just a lot of fun.
So during the summer, we start programming our events for the fall, and I was sitting around with my colleagues, and I was like, oh man, like, I'm such a fine arts person, and you know, I'm really excited to have this chair, but I want to do new things with it, so things that, you know, other chairs haven't done with it before. Just a colleague of mine was talking about a wine and paint event that she went to, and I was like, well, what if I turned that into an alcohol alternative event, and we did a spin-off of that, so that's really where it came from. So I really think that everybody enjoyed it, and it sold out really fast, so I hope the future chairs decide to do it or something like it, because it's definitely a fun addition to Alcohol Awareness Week.
Hey, that did look pretty fun. The teacher made it look easy.
Yeah, some of us struggled at first, but it was totally worth it. I want to have another night like that again soon.
Well, how would you feel about a film festival?
It sounds cool, but I've never been to one. What's it like?
Well, I don't personally know, but Colin Valencik does. He recently got the chance to attend the Burning River Film Festival, which featured films about the trail running community. Let's watch.
My name is Jessica Croissant, and I am the founder of the Burning River Film Festival. And there's some really cool, inspiring films that new and upcoming filmmakers make and post on YouTube of these beautiful trails that we run and the races that we do. And they inspire me. And I was thinking, wouldn't it be awesome if we could feature some of these films together, you know, in a festival type format? But more than that, I wanted it to be like an actual festival, not just films. I wanted it to be like a big trail running party where everybody who's involved in the trail running community could bring whatever their offering is. So whether it's you're a shoe shop owner, you design cool t-shirts, you make bracelets, you're in a band, maybe you're just a good cook. Everybody who's involved in the trail running community could come together and we could have like a big party to celebrate the community itself. We've got two films that we're showing from a filmmaker that's from the Cleveland area. He has since moved to Colorado. His name is Matt Trape. And one of the films that we're going to be showing is called The Double. It's just come out and it's about an ultra runner that got picked for the lotteries for the Western States 100 and Hard Rock 100. He made another one about specifically Hard Rock called Kiss the Rock. So we'll be featuring both of Matt's films, which is exciting. Solomon makes running shoes that are amazing and they're really supportive of the trail running community. They make excellent films and they're also a sponsor of our event. So we're showing one of my favorite Solomon shows, or you know, films I would say. It's called Trail Dogs. A lot of people who are trail runners love their dogs and bring their dogs. There's another film that Spencer Shoebridge has made at the Mohican 100 Trail Marathon, or trail and ultra running races. He was there this last summer. Another film that we're showing is called The Ultimate Triathlon, and it's about a man who swims, bikes, and runs from Morocco to Monaco. And he does the whole thing within 12 days. And it's staggering. I would invite people to look into supporting the Conservancy and their Trails Forever project. I would encourage people to try out trail running if they haven't done it before. Don't be afraid if you can't run the whole mile. Cool thing about trail running is there's hiking.
Well, that brings us to the end of the show. Only two more episodes left in the season.
The season is passing way too quickly.
Yeah.
But if you want to keep up with everything we're doing for the next two episodes, you can always like us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ZTV Lowdown. I'm Josh Gowdy.
I'm Jenna Remolt.
And that's the Lowdown.
This program was produced by ZTV at the University of Akron. To find out how you can make Emmy-winning media, visit the UA School of Communication online. ZTV. Make media. Make a difference.